Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. And we have had apologies from committee member Mark Griffin. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item six in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item two, which is to take evidence on the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 Incidental Provision Regulations 2023 from Patrick Harvey, Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights. And Mr. Harvey is joined for this item by Poppy Pryor, who is a lawyer from the Scottish Government, and Yvonne Gavan, who is a team leader at the Housing Services and Rented Sector Reform Unit at the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you. I'm happy to be here today to present the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 Incidental Provision Regulations 2023. Now, as we've discussed with the committee previously, you're aware that the Emergency Act that we introduced last year had three key aims. Firstly, to protect tenants, stabilising their housing costs by freezing rents. Secondly, to reduce the impact of eviction and homelessness through a moratorium on evictions. And thirdly, to avoid tenants being evicted from the rented sector by a landlord wanting to raise rents between tenancies during the temporary measures and reduce unlawful evictions. Last month, the committee considered and voted for regulations to extend some of these provisions beyond the 31st of March to the end of September this year. And I was pleased to see that Parliament also voted to approve these regulations, ensuring that these important protections continue for tenants given the challenging and uncertain economic times that remain. While it's crucial that some of these emergency provisions continue for the time being, the Emergency Act is, of course, temporary. Therefore, it's equally important that we plan for when those protections come to an end. During the passage of the bill through Parliament, we acknowledged that termination of the rent cap may lead to a large number of private landlords seeking to increase their rent all at once, which could cause significant and unmanageable rent increases for tenants. In these circumstances, the existing rent adjudication process would need to be temporarily modified to provide a suitable adjudication mechanism that's fit for purpose. That's why the Emergency Act contains a regulation making power to temporarily reform the existing rent adjudication process, which was brought in by the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Act 2016. This would support our transition out of the emergency measures and help to mitigate any unintended consequence arising from bringing the temporary rent cap to an end. Schedule 3 of the Emergency Act therefore provides ministers with that power, and this short affirmative instrument being considered today makes a minor technical amendment to Schedule 3 to put beyond doubt the powers conferred on the Scottish ministers function as intended. It does this by renaming a title and heading, renumbering a section and correcting a reference. It will ensure clarity if and when Scottish ministers choose to exercise the powers conferred on them in that schedule, which are subject to the affirmative procedure, and it will be subject to scrutiny and approval both by this committee and by Parliament. Convener, the severity of the cost crisis and the urgent need to respond quickly meant that the Emergency Act had to be drafted and delivered at pace, ensuring additional protection could be offered to tenants as quickly as possible. So this short technical instrument therefore clarifies a small part of that drafting, ensuring that the important rent adjudication provisions work as they're intended to when the time is right to bring the emergency provisions to an end. So I'd like to thank the committee for their scrutiny of this instrument, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Thanks very much for clarifying the clarification in that regulation, and I invite members to do any members have any questions? Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning
to officials. I wanted to return to some of the questions I raised on our evidence session on this on the 28th of February with regards to the use of data to measure the Scottish Government's intentions around this policy and impact the legislation is having, and specifically with regards to the use of private landlord registration data. I wanted to ask the Minister what assessment he's made of the use of that data for real-life information of what's happening around this policy, given that that registration lasts for 3 years. So if people are leaving, we won't necessarily know that these properties are coming out of the market. And what wider assessment now are government planning to do of the impact of the policy?
I thank Mr. Briggs for the question. While it's not technically relevant to the instrument that's before us today, which is about the correction of or clarification of drafting around the introduction of rent adjudication measures, if and when or as and when the temporary measures come to an end. I think it's clear that when we made reference to the landlord registration figures earlier, we made it clear that it is only an administrative source of data. It doesn't provide the rich granularity of data that I think all stakeholders recognise is necessary. There is a longer-term reform that needs to be done to ensure that we have data collection in the private rented sector at the level at which we need it. But while we do have that admittedly limited source of information through the landlord registration scheme, I think it shows no decrease as yet, and perhaps a slight increase, only very, very marginal increase in the number of registered properties since before the emergency measures come into force. Of course, Mr. Briggs is right that there would be a time lag between any landlord seeking to make a decision about their future in the industry and deregistrations. But we acknowledge that that is the case, and we've presented the information that we have available to us at the moment.
Okay. Thank you for that. And just finally, is the Scottish Government therefore looking at information to assess what impact this has had and what potential loss we're going to see of people potentially leaving the private rental sector? And when is that likely to be published? Because if we look at different schemes across the world, there has been a sort of cut-off point or cliff edge where people have left the market, and whether or not this will prevent that potentially in terms of rent increases, but not necessarily for people deciding that when they can, they'll withdraw private rented properties from market and the impact that will have. So I'm not clear where the Scottish Government have any role to prevent that, and actually where that data is actively being looked at now and provided to different local authorities who might then end up facing the consequences of more people declaring themselves homeless.
Well, of course, we do have a responsibility not only to ensure that the temporary emergency measures are necessary and proportionate, but also that they are appropriate, that they fit with the housing objectives that we have, as well as taking that approach to the new housing bill to ensure that it's consistent with what we seek to achieve in housing. And what we seek to achieve in housing is, takes us at starting point, the recognition that the right to adequate housing is a human right. That has not been delivered by everybody in what is, you know, a situation in which the level of regulation on a number of standards is significantly different between the private and social rented sector. So we're seeking to reduce the gap in outcomes between those types of tenure. Our experience over the long term is that increasing quality of regulation of the private rented sector is clearly compatible with growth and viability in the private rented sector. And certainly the emergency measures, while I've noticed some people seeking to blame them for decisions around new supply of rented accommodation, the emergency measures have no impact on initial rent setting, only on in-tenancy annual rent increases. So, you know, I recognise that there are some people who will argue against any form of protection for tenants or regulation in the market. I don't think that extreme position would be appropriate, but we do ensure and seek to continue to ensure that the measures that we take strike the appropriate balance between safeguards for landlords, which are included in the Emergency Act, but also continuing to expand protection for tenants.
Okay, thank you. And maybe, you know, as a question more straightforwardly, are your officials looking at that data to publish it so that we are acutely aware of the impact that,
well, as I said in the
these policies
response
coming to
your
end will have?
As I said in response to your first question, I think everybody, landlord organisations, tenant organisations, housing academics and the government, recognise that there is a significant need for additional data and a greater depth, detail and granularity of data in the private rented sector. That is a long-term piece of work, and there'll be further work that the government brings for this committee's attention and for the attention of Parliament to improve the collection of data in the private rented sector. For the time being, we've noted that the information that we do have available, limited though it is, from the landlord registration scheme, does not show a drop-off in the number of properties available.
OK, thank you. Thanks for that.
I thank the Minister for the evidence today and for going into a bit of detail there that was kind of beyond quite the scope of what we're looking at just now. We now turn to agenda item 3, which is consideration of the motion on the instrument. And I invite the Minister to move motion S6M07858, that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 Incidental Provision Regulations 2023 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. Do members have any comments? No comments. Is there anything that you would wish to add?
Convener, I think we've covered it in the previous item on the
agenda.
Thank you.
The question is that motion S6M07858 in the name of Patrick Harvey be approved. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you. And the committee will publish a report setting out its recommendation on the instrument in the coming days. And I now suspend business for 5 minutes to allow setup for the round table discussion. Shall we get going? The next item on our agenda today is a roundtable discussion about community planning. This is the fourth session in our post-legislative scrutiny of the Community Empowerment Act 2015. And the inquiry is looking at the impact of the Act on community planning and how community planning partnerships respond to significant events such as the COVID-19 pandemic and the current cost of living crisis. Many thanks to our panel for joining us today. We're looking forward to speaking with you about your experiences of community planning in your various different communities across Scotland. We're joined in the room by Ellen Wright, who is a community councillor in Glasgow, I believe. Lionel Most, who's the chair and secretary of Dowan Hill, Hindland and Kelvinside Community Council. And Louise Robb, who's the chair of Largo Communities Together, which is a development trust. And online, we're joined by David Watson, who is trust manager at the Kyle of Sutherland Development Trust. For those of you who are online, you can let the clerks know if you'd like to reply to a question by typing or join in the conversation even by typing an R in the chat function. And there's no need for those of you in the room or online to turn your microphones or turn on or off your microphones, as we'll do that for you. And I'm going to begin our conversation this morning by inviting everyone to very briefly introduce themselves, and I will begin. And I'm Ariane Burgess, and I'm the convener of the committee, and I'm also an MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Yes, I'm Ellen Wright. I am the secretary of High Knight Swords and Daddy's Land Community Council in Glasgow. I'm also a member of the Area Partnership for Ward 14 and the North West Sector Glasgow Community Planning Partnership.
Hi folks, I'm Willie Coffey. I'm deputy convener of the committee, and I'm also the member for the wonderful constituency of Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley.
I'm Lionel Most. I'm the chair of Downhill, Hindland and Kelvinside Community Council. We've got 12,500 residents. I am the representative on the Area Partnership, and I am the substitute for the Sector Partnership within the community planning chain.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Miles Briggs. I'm Conservative MSP for Lothian Region. So welcome to Edinburgh today.
Thank you. I'm Louise Robb, Chair of Largo Communities Together, which is the area for our community development trust. And we've been around since 2017, so quite young.
Good morning. I'm Marie McNair, MSP. I represent Clydebank and Mogai.
Good morning. I'm Paul McLennan. I'm the MSP for East Lothian. I was previously 15 years councillor and council leader in East Lothian, and 10 years as a community councillor as well in Dunbar Community Council.
And online, David, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, I'm David Watson. I'm the manager of the Kyle of Sutherland Development Trust, a development trust up in the far north of Scotland. We've been established since 2011. We also take an active role in community planning. We've employed support staff for the Sutherland Community Planning Partnership, which is a subset of the Highland Community Planning Partnership, for a number of years. And as a result, we sit as a community organisation, as a full partner on the Sutherland Community Partnership.
Thanks. And Annie?
Thank you, convener. My name is Annie Wells, and I am the regional member for Glasgow.
Thank you. During the inquiry, we have each been exploring a particular theme, and I wanted to invite Annie to begin our conversation this morning with some questions about the particular challenges that face your community. Annie, do you want to get the conversation going?
Yeah, thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everyone. Sorry I'm not there in person this morning. I'm looking at sort of inequalities and challenges that face the local communities. We have had witnesses in our evidence sessions describing the challenges that they face, and especially firefighting responses that we've had to see during recent crises. And I just wondered if we could just kick off by saying, what do you believe are the main challenges facing communities? And I think as a Glasgow member, I think we'll go to Ellen first, please.
Yeah, the main challenge we have at the moment is obviously cost of living. The facilities that we have are in our area are unevenly spread. In our area, we do have one of the thriving places, which I believe that works well. But when it comes to the community planning partnership, we do not have very much engagement with them at all, apart from through area partnerships. I don't think we're particularly listened to. We're a tick box exercise at the end of the day. That doesn't help in my community, because if we're not in the thriving places, tend to be that we're ignored. We do have problems as well. We do have areas that we need looked at. We maybe need to rethink whether it should be so broad-based and look into smaller communities of need within a ward rather than just in one area. Thank you.
Anybody else want to come in on that? Lionel?
Okay, just to follow up on that, Glasgow is quite a poor... Sorry, I'm the chair of Downhill Highland Kelvinside Community Council. We've got 12,500 members. We're probably the most affluent area in the city. But we sit beside, for example, Partick in our ward, which is a very poor area. And so when community planning is thought about, they look at our ward as a whole, and they look at us who, well, we have no public buildings in our area other than the schools, but an area like ours really doesn't need that. We can, to a certain extent, fend for ourselves. But when you look at us, and we're lumped together with quite a poor area, the SIMD statistics are dragged down because we can manage, but they really can't. So I think there ought to be a more nuanced look at different areas and see... I mean, there are parts of Partick which are OK because it's beside the university as well. But there are bits of it that are, unlike in our area, but there are bits of it which are really quite poor and deprived and are not getting the benefit of the kind of facilities that the public authorities have, because they're seen in conjunction with these wealthier areas. So that's one challenge. Another challenge is, as Ellen said, that our community representatives, even I, who live in a kind of bubble, know that there are deprivations in the surrounding areas. And yet, in a recent programme that the council did, they didn't really engage with us properly to find out who was in the greatest need. Until the very last minute, when they told us they were just looking for red flags. And they really didn't want us to make any changes to what they were doing. So, and it was only after we created a big fuss that they realised that, well, if you're giving money to three lots of people here who are doing the same job and three lots of people here doing the same job, why are you not spreading that out a bit? And we managed to persuade them actually to change it a wee bit, but they weren't too happy about that. So there needs to be much more engagement with the community at the earliest stage. You see, in Glasgow, the community planning, as I understand it, there's a strategic partnership at the top with absolutely no community involvement. That's the police, the fire, and so on. And the challenge for the community is, and then the next one down are the sectors, and they've only got one representative from each ward. And then you've got the area partnerships with one representative from each community council. So the thing is, it's a match of communication. And although the minutes are available, the minutes are very scant, and the community's not getting a proper picture of what is going on at the strategic level and at these other sector levels. So it needs to be much better and much more communication about what they're doing. And I mean, I was reading the evidence that the two council officers gave on the 7th of March. And to be honest with you, they were both saying this is a learning process. They've had 8 years to learn about it. So they need to get their skates on a bit and learn a bit more. But there needs to be more communication with the community who has the local knowledge.
Thanks very much for that. And hopefully this process that we're doing at the Parliament with the committee will help some of that, unearth some of these things. Louise, what are your experiences in?
So I think our experience might be a little different. So Largo and the Largo ward are 3,000 voting residents in a relatively well-off area. And you would think that there wouldn't be deprivation, but actually what we found during the COVID time was there was a lot of elderly people, very isolated, family scattered around the world. So what, from that knowledge, we are in the middle of a local place plan process. We're about halfway through. We've been very lucky in that we have been able to employ a part-time development officer to help us run that and get it working. It's going to be in two levels, so there'll be the local place plan that will go up to the Fife Council to be part of the Fife plan, or at least our ideas around that. The rest of it really is our own action plan, and we really want to just kick that into action ourselves, and we will. The one thing we're struggling with at community level is we are all volunteers. And we are trying to do, in some cases, the work that would have been done at council level with volunteers. So I think a little bit of capacity so that we can continue to be board members and employ some operational level would really change significantly what we could do. We ran a very good COVID resilience group that did operationally do things. We're also covering resilience going forward, and we have a number of other projects and also availability of land. Our biggest request from our local place plan at the moment is affordable homes. And we would like to do that maybe using the rural housing burden route, developing a housing trust. But that's a bit down the line, but that's where we're heading. So we're pretty active. We're not saying we can't do things, but the capacity is going to be a struggle. We have good engagement and people are giving a lot. But really, can we ask volunteers to run toilets and to do all sorts of things? That we'd like to be able to pay someone so that someone has jobs, you know, people have jobs. So, yeah, that's where we're sitting, if that's any help.
Thank you. That's great and tremendous that you're on the brink of considering starting some community-led housing initiative there. And that's tremendous. David, do you want to come in on the challenges facing folk in communities in Sutherland?
Yeah, I mean, obviously we're very remote rural, and that plays a bigger part. There's some parts of Sutherland that are 2.5 hours by car from Inverness with very little options for transport links. So we're certainly not anywhere near the commuter belt for well-paid jobs. And certainly, you know, we've been dealing with deprivation and inequalities for a number of years. Indeed, in 2019, prior to COVID and prior to the cost of living crisis, there was 42% of people in Sutherland deemed to be in fuel poverty, and 1 in 3 children were deemed to be in poverty in Sutherland prior to COVID and the cost of living crisis. What those figures must be like now, I would shudder to think. So deprivation and inequalities has been a big issue with us. And the cost of energy is driving that up. We have a lack of broadband speeds, which makes with us not being in the commuter belt, makes it harder for it to earn well-paid jobs. And childcare availability, low levels of public and community transport, and basically, I think cost of living is obviously a big issue. And the high prices of energy are particularly, I mean, that's an injustice, that the high prices of energy that we face, considering that we're a producer of energy, is something that is really hard to bear. The environmental pressures and the transition to net zero is obviously a huge concern for the future of our communities. But the real issue that I see for the future of remote rural communities at the moment is the depopulation that we're threatened by. Sutherland itself has got estimations of 11% of population loss by 2040. Caithness is even higher, I think 21%. And there's only 12,000 people in Sutherland. You know, we can't be affording to lose many more. And it's a really ageing profile. So we really need to be not just accepting or mitigating the fact that depopulation is coming. We need to be actually looking at dealing with repopulation if we want our rural communities to survive. And to do that, we have to create jobs, we have to create broadband, we have to have super fast broadband. It's more necessary here when we're not in the commuter belt than anywhere else. We have to have better transport links, and we have to really look at homes as a real issue. And I speak about homes rather than housing. We need homes for people to live, and the rural burden is a great way of ensuring that they remain as homes. We talk about affordable housing, but the price of building a house now is meaning that affordable housing is becoming something that I'm not sure can be delivered to most people. So attainable housing is what we need to think about. We need to allow young people with, you know, especially with children, to be able to live and work in our areas. I would love to be judged on primary school rules, raising primary school rules and attacking those and making sure that we can have the conditions so that parents with primary school age children wish to live and work in rural areas is a real way where we work. So if we do a kind of vertical target of primary school rules, but horizontally we present the things that are needed, which is homes, broadband, transport, childcare, well-paid jobs. Those are the things that are really, really going to make a difference. Skills. So from our perspective, the biggest challenge we're facing is depopulation, but everything else, such as the cost of living, existing poverty, environmental pressures, feeds into that. So it's a big challenge, but it's something that we're certainly at our planning partnership level are willing to take on.
Thanks very much for that, David. Annie, do you have anything more you want to go on?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of bits that I'd still like to go on. And obviously we spoke about the cost of living crisis, and I think everyone has mentioned that. But I was just wondering if any of you had any evidence or experiences of where community planning has improved inequalities.
Anybody want to come in on that? Lionel.
Well, I mean, we did have the Glasgow Communities Fund recently, which was spread out across the city, but I wouldn't have said wholeheartedly that it improved inequalities. It did help a little bit. And as I was alluding to earlier, it was a bit skewed because of the lack of community knowledge. And I feel that if the community had been involved at a much earlier stage, it could have been spread out. I know it was a limited amount and there was a much, much greater application than there was funding. But it would, with a bit of community input, it would have spread much more fairly across the city. So with community input, yes, and with the right kind of aims in view, yes. But it's not having any evidence that it's completely successful.
Thanks, Lionel. And I believe, David, you want to come in as well.
A good example we had recently was that Highland Council made some a cost of living emergency funding available across Highland Region, which, as you all know, is a huge region. If Sutherland was to get what it was due on a population basis as a percentage, I think we would have been due something like 27,000 out of that. It was application based, so it was for community organisations to apply to. But because the Sutherland Community Planning Partnership works particularly effectively, and we have a number of subgroups for fuel poverty, food poverty, community resilience, etc., those groups were made aware and supported each other and were supported by the agencies involved in the community partnership to make applications that were fit for purpose and actually dealt with the situation that needed to be dealt with. So the fact that we speak regularly, we understand where the needs are. And as a result of the applications made by Sutherland organisations, instead of the 27,000 that we would have got if it was divvied up by population, we actually ended up securing £68,000, which is 250% of what we should have got. I put that down squarely to the fact of the community planning, the support that our community organisations get and the knowledge that our community organisations get from the partners by working together well. And I'm convinced that that's why Sutherland does well when these funding bids open up. Another good example is my development trust was recently very lucky to secure Invest in Communities funding, a large fund from the Scottish Government. There is no doubt in my mind that our role in community planning in Sutherland and our ability to demonstrate that played a huge part in giving the confidence that we are an organisation that has got the governance and the strategic knowledge to be able to deliver that. So being involved in community planning certainly works for us from a community level. And you know, we have several subgroups that are forging away. We have a new group on homes, specifically on homes, and we really hope to be delivering that with cross-community working together. So instead of just looking at one housing plot in Durness, we're going to be looking at the whole of Sutherland and seeing where we're going. So we see small wins with funding, and certainly, though, I think the next few years we need to move on to bigger stuff with big funding, with homes as they need in Largo and other places. So that's where we want to see the it move towards. Instead of talking about 68,000, we may be talking about 6.8 million for homes.
Thanks, David. Louise, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, thank you, David, for mentioning us there as well. I think we are rural and we do have a real housing need. I would also say that the funding that came through the COVID period for the difficult parts like, you know, heating and the ability to help people who were struggling, we were able to access that funding quite well through DTAS. And we used that and we still have small amounts of it going into the right places. So we felt actually quite well resourced through that organisation. Our next challenge really is land and the bigger funding that we could use to really make a difference. And ours is our school role. We want young people with children to be able to come back and populate a place that's become very much a retirement place or a place for Airbnbs to be bought and leased. And we're in danger of tipping in the balance there between what's a community and what's a, you know, holiday park, bluntly. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, it's an issue across mm-hmm. Scotland and the rural beautiful parts that people want to visit. Yeah. I'm going to move on to the next theme, which is usually led by Mark Griffin, and it's around community empowerment. And David, I wanted to come back to you because when you talk about, you know, the work that you were able to do in terms of shifting the amount of money that you got from 27,000 to 68,000, it sounds to me that's a lot about really great communication and a good structure and relationships. And so when the community, and I'm aware also in Highland from a previous session that you were involved in, our first evidence session, that not all areas in Highland have such a satisfactory experience. So I'd be interested to hear from you, what was put in place or what evolved to make it so good that we could understand and, you know, support other community planning partnerships to kind of get to that place that you are at?
Yeah, it was an interesting session we had about a month ago, and certainly I felt like an outlier because in Sutherland we have a very good experience of community planning, and that didn't seem to be the case everywhere. And that is reflected, though, that across Highland, the Sutherland Community Partnership is held in very, very high regard because of how we work. I think that the difference that we have in Sutherland, certainly I think there is an aspect that the partnership and the input is very much non-political here. We have very few councillors and a huge, well, at least a third of them are independent. So it is less political and it's more about looking at the team dynamic. It's certainly, from my experience, and I've been involved now for 4.5 years, even though I grew up in Sutherland, I've only been involved in the partnership for the last 4.5 years. It certainly is. Everybody pulls together, everybody sees the bigger picture, and everybody is looking at trying to deal with the issues that the research that we undertake shows that we need to deal with. One of the biggest things, though, is that for the last 5 years, we've been able to get funding through various sources to have staff that support the Community Planning Partnership and support the committees and do development work. They're not admin staff. They are staff that do development work. And there's a number of initiatives that would not have happened if there wasn't the support of paid staff undertake those. So I definitely feel that because we've managed to be able to have those staff, that has made a massive difference to Sutherland. And there has been periods where we haven't had funding, where we have seen things, despite the hard work, not being able to be delivered as easily. I still think we deliver to a high standard, but not as readily as we can when we've got staffing there. And the thing is, we've only got funding at the moment till the end of March 2024. What happens then, who knows, as far as our ability to move things forward. But I certainly know that the partners, the subgroups that we create, the initiatives that we undertake, and the way that those are staffed by professional development workers who can help move things forward really helps to take things to the next level. And as I say, that along with the team dynamic. And the other thing I think that makes us slightly different is that there is real community involvement. Kyle Sutherland Development Trust is a full partner. We're not a statutory partner. We don't have to be a partner, but we've been made a full partner because the partners understand that we have the ability to contribute and make things better and speak and move things along for the community. So there is a community voice there other than our third sector interface or the membership groups that represent the communities. There is actually community groups who are dealing at the coal face with fuel poverty, with food poverty, with environmental issues. And I think because we have that input, as I say, alongside the staff and everything really works. And the one, every even the biggest blackest clouds have silver linings, and COVID was certainly one of the blackest clouds we'll ever face. But the ability to move online and the ability in a huge and spread out geographical area where if somebody's coming from to Rora from Durness, that could be their whole day. Now they have the ability to have the hour and a half in the meeting. So our meetings are now much, much better attended. I think it takes away slightly from the networking, away from the agenda, which is probably something we're going to have to face. But I think we've certainly got more involvement on many levels because we are actually engaging on that level. But so I think there's a number of things that have actually come together and worked for Sutherland. I think Caithness works relatively well as well. From what I've heard, it's got a very, very good reputation. And I think the support from Highlands and Islands Enterprise at a local level really helps that. So, team dynamic, staffing, working together, community involvement, and not just having statutory partners sitting around and chatting about what might work. We're actually looking to see what needs to happen and then trying to deal with it.
Thanks very much. That's very helpful. And just kind of going to throw into the rest of you, if you're sparked by that, but also just as I'd be interested to hear in your responses in this conversation, kind of what do you think community empowerment really looks like? I mean, I think we've heard it there in a way from David, but from your own perspectives as well. Ellen?
Oh. My feeling and my experience of it in Glasgow is that we're a tick box exercise at the end of any process. And the one that Lyra was speaking about is a recent example. That's probably why it sticks most in our minds. We were invited along to the Glasgow Funding Review Panel, and really we had to practically rewrite what was produced for the Northwest sector. We should have been brought in, and the third sector should be brought in at the beginning. We're left too late. I'm glad you're here today. The reason I came is I was actually told that you would listen. We don't always feel that we're listened to, or we might be listened to, but no action would be taken on it, or it's smoothed over as some bland minute in a meeting that we met and a discussion took place, not what the discussion was about. And that really is what our participation boils down to now.
So the first step of community empowerment for you would be to actually be at the table in the kind of designing of the ideas, the projects,
and
of the funds.
I have heard that from one of the Thriving Places organisations. We're not involved in anything at the beginning at all, and we need to be. or we need to be listened to, even ask us what we want before you go into committee rooms and discuss it or whatever. But no, we feel that we're a tick box exercise, I think is the best way to put it.
Thanks so much for that. Lionel, what does community empowerment look like? What would be happening if it was working better than tick box exercises being brought into the conversation a bit late in the game by the sound of it?
That's right. I mean, rather than feeling empowered, I think we feel a bit impotent, actually. Mm. The way it's structured, and I wasn't aware of this, you know, until quite recently, that each local authority has a different way of approaching community empowerment. And our local authority, the top structure, the design structure, has no community representatives at all. So it consists of things like the fire and the police, which is fine, and the health board, but there are also representatives of colleges and housing associations. And we can't see how they can possibly be part of the community where they're effectively private bodies. And so then we're reliant on this just information trickling down, but invariably it's a very stark minute a report was brought in and approved, that sort of thing. So we feel that we don't know what's going on, and when we ask, actually, in this recent thing we were asking for more information, and they said, no, you're not getting that information, that's confidential. So I couldn't see that. I mean, it's a long story, but I think, you know, that's when they're supposed to be transparent, especially when the councillor who was leading it said it was a robust and transparent process. You know, I felt that was disingenuous, and I told them. The other thing is, as Ellen was saying about the tick box, I noticed from Shaw Anderson's evidence that he talked about the development forum getting up close and personal with people. But these are things, it's called the Community Council Development Forum, and good on them, they have it every quarter, and it's a Saturday morning. But we have a presentation, not a consultation. So we have someone there telling us what is going on. For example, there was one recently about Glasgow and the low emission zone, for example, but they were just telling us what they were doing. They weren't listening to us. For example, I mean, I could have chipped in about the lack of electric charging points, but they're not interested in listening. They're just telling us what they're doing. So community empowerment means to me the ability to be in at the table on an early occasion, and at least to have some people, and to have good communication, good and detailed communication from these early discussions.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much. Louise, what's your experience of community empowerment?
Probably quite different from a smaller community. So we kind of just take, you know, the bull by the horns ourselves, really, in making the relationships with the bodies around us, like Fife Coast and Countryside Trust. They have a pathway that comes right through us. So, you know, we invite their CEO to come and do talks with us so that we get to know them, we get to know how to ask them questions. Maybe naively, we are putting our trust in our local place plan process, and we know that what will come from that is what we will action and what we will take systemically and put it into place best we can. We work right alongside the Largo Area Community Council. I mean, some of them sit on some of our subgroups. That's how small we are. So it's human relationships that are actually working, not bodies. And that seems to be working for us. We do have a lot of councillors, you know, coming into the process, and sometimes we keep them out. sometimes we want them in, but I think we need to be able to make up our minds and then ask for the help we want, as opposed to being told what we'd be coming. So maybe we're being naive, but that's the route we're on right now. And I think with the development officer we've got, we'll have a year and a half of her to put into place our top actions, and the actual local place plan piece, the formal part, will be lodged next June. Probably earlier than that, actually. We hope to have it in by the end of the year. And that's the part we have to live in hope, that the planning at Fife level will take into consideration the things our community are saying they would like to happen. And we're mostly stating it in the positive as opposed to things we don't want to happen. So yeah, that's where we're at. Maybe a very different experience from a city where the big thing's going on.
Mm. Yes, I mean, that's quite a good point. I think it's when you're dealing with so many more people and many more complex issues and trying to find your way through that. Lionel.
Can I just say that, you know, I do accept that Glasgow's a very large area, that sometimes people are completely apathetic and there are community councils who are dormant. Sometimes people shout too loud, but the authorities should be smart enough to be able to work their way through that.
Right. So is there some need for some skills development there in terms of communication and relationship building, that kind of thing?
That's correct. To be able to interpret what is going on behind the silence or the chat.
Right. Yes. Good point. What's going on behind the silence? Ellen.
Yeah. Could I also make a point that I presume it's the same all over? Everything's online. Mm. Even this survey was online. Mm. Information is online. There's so many of our citizens who do not go online, do not have the facilities, either through poverty, age, and that's a massive amount of people. I have tried to get hard copies. Just now we've had consultations in Glasgow City Centre. And I believe the Glasgow City Centre is a matter for all of Glasgow, not just for the city centre. And to discuss it with an elderly forum in my area who are not digitally connected, I've asked for hard copies. Have I got them? No. Equally, I have asked for community wealth building from the Scottish Government, and I get sent a link and told to print out 45 pages myself. Mm. I do appreciate that the days where we print out thousands of copies of things, but even if there was a central place in Glasgow, we could pick up the Glasgow Housing Strategy, which is, I think, 65 pages. Have hard copies available. People can't participate online. And I do think that needs to be looked at. They are excluding massive amounts of our population.
I think that's a very good point in terms of how can we have community empowerment if we're missing a whole section of people who can't engage in that way. Lionel.
To follow on from that, sorry. They are quite good, to be fair, with people whose first language is not English.
Mm.
So, you know, elderly people have a voice too.
Mm. Right, so we they know that there are systems in place that could be easily adapted, most likely. Okay. Paul, I'm going to come over to you, and if you wanted to introduce the role of the third sector and communities.
Yeah, I've been focusing on the third sector and community involvement. Some of the feedback we've had so far has been around about that it's very mixed from area to area, and I think we're kind of picking up on that. But central to what's kind of coming through is that it's... there's a need for recognition about what the community is doing, how they can be resourced adequately. And I think, again, we've heard that kind of coming through. So I suppose the question for me would be, if you had to take a step back, as we are doing just now, how would you like to interact with your local authority? What you're saying, what they're not doing at the moment, but what could they do in terms of that? I suppose the key thing for me would be, when are you getting involved in, and when would you like to get involved in the decision making? And where do you see the funding, or what level of funding would you need to feel that you're doing the best job that you possibly can? That the second question, maybe you can just encompass this as well, is really just talking about the lessons that we learned from COVID. Because what happened in COVID, obviously, was when COVID happened, local authorities and local organisations literally had to turn around overnight and get action plans and things overnight. So, again, lessons learned from COVID that probably we've not learned and moving on from now. So I'll probably come to yourself first of all, Louise, just on that.
So during COVID, we felt Fife Council's resilience help was really good to us. I mean, within, I think this is the anniversary today of the shutdown.
It would be, yeah.
And I can remember us meeting as a COVID group this day 3 years ago, going, OK, what can we do as the church, the community, council and Largo communities together as a trust? How do we pull together? And we did manage to act. We invited some of the councillors who you attended that day, or just about attended that day. So I feel we are quite well supported. The piece that's difficult for us now is we're growing lots of things, and we are reliant on the volunteers and, in fact, board members doing operational work when we're trying to do full-time jobs. I mean, I have a full-time business, but we're trying to do that. And we're going to run out of capacity. And how do we make that step from to provide more services at the community level without it having to be more volunteering by the same few, but also provide some jobs because they are needed in our community. So I think that's what we're grappling with. Incidentally, we are getting a little bit of help from an Accelerate programme, which are coming to do some facilitation with the board around how we look towards that next step. So I would say we are being helped. Don't know what our outcomes will be from that. But actually, you know, if you look out there, you can get the help. But I think that gap between the volunteer level and how we can help organise the volunteers at an operational level with some paid jobs is going to be our struggle, if I'm speaking from our experience.
Okay. David, I'll probably come to yourself just now, but just the same, kind of the same question, but you mentioned obviously the role of development, DTAS, and I've had examples of working with DTAS and find them really a great organisation to work with.
They've been invaluable.
So I don't know if it's maybe looking at more funding, for example, like DTAS, to try and build that capacity in there. Mm-hmm. Louise, I don't know if you want to comment on that. David, and I'll come across to yourself on the broader point, but also in around about DTAS and about what support are for organisations like DTAS. And then I'll come on obviously to Ellen and Lionel about the broader issue. But Louise, just on DTAS, I don't know if we just on...
So we've engaged with DTAS since we set up. We've had a number of development officers, all with different kind of skills. And we have found them, on the whole, extremely good at supporting us in, you know, taking the next step. It also gives us access a little to legal advice, accountancy advice, tax advice. So, you know, as a body, I think they have been invaluable to us. In supporting us to make steps forward. Yeah, I don't know if that can help you anymore.
No, Louise, that's great.
Yeah.
David, just on that point, obviously, on Development Trust about DTAS, but on the wider role, where would you like to be involved in the decision-making? And I suppose, is it resourced adequately? And I think you've kind of touched on that point as well, but just on the DTAS and Development Trust point of view.
Yeah, I mean, we're members of DTAS and hugely respect the help that they give to organisations. We're slightly different. I mean, we're in a relatively rural area with small population. The area we cover is 1,700 people. We've got 15 staff at our Development Trust. We've been quite successful for a number of years, and we work over a wider area, so we work over Sutherland. The DTAS funding for officers that's spoken about, that's kind of now been absorbed into the Investing Communities Fund. So that is part of the bigger... It was given to DTAS by the Scottish Government previously for DTAS to give to anchor organisations. And I think reinforcing this terminology of anchor organisations and community anchor organisations, and particularly with respect to what happened during COVID, when the anchor organisations were fundamental to the response, especially in rural communities where people were genuinely not willing to leave their homes and didn't know how they were going to get 12 miles to Tain or 25 miles to Dornoch to do their shopping. You know, so how were they supported by Development Trust doing that? DTAS offer high-level support, legal, and that kind of stuff, which is invaluable. And the funding that they intermittently get, and they're in the same position that they're always going about for funding. As far as how we've managed to support the community planning process here, we've gone through a number of funds. The Aspiring Communities Fund is where we initially got funding from, which is a Scottish Government fund, and now the staff that we have that supports community planning comes from Highlands and Islands Enterprise through their Strengthening Communities wing. And what it does is it allows each of our subgroups to have properly researched action plans and allows those action plans to be kept up to date and the action plans to be delivered against. And it allows then some coordination and sort of responsibility given to different organisations for different aspects. And a number of community groups, a number of anchor organisations and development trusts and other organisations across Sutherland get responsibility for delivery of aspects for community planning's actions. So what it does here is it actually widens the net of who can be involved by having that support. Whereas if you have a lack of support, I think it almost comes right back to the statutory partners, because there is no way of throwing the net wider. So we've had intermittent funding, and it's been welcome. We've had some superb staff. We seem to be a recruitment agency for the likes of Highland Council and Highlands Islands Enterprise. Do we recruit staff and they keep nicking them? But that's probably a backhanded compliment to us. But we've had some really big successes, and we delivered in 2020, I think, or was it end of 2019, a Sutherland Fuel Poverty Summit, which got national media coverage, and we had cabinet secretaries there representing us, and that was as a result of our staff and the hard work that they were able to put in to support the networks. Now, what you have to remember about the statutory partners as well, it's not just in the third sector, but the statutory partners to a degree are voluntary in this as well, because they've got full-time roles to fulfil. And I think that one of the problems that the staff help with is that we have statutory partners, whether it be the police, fire service, NHS, who are very busy doing their other roles. Sometimes they are not trained in community planning when they get the roles that kind of designate them as the representative in the community planning partnership. And we also have a huge turnover of those as people move on. I think we've had 5 chairs through the police since I've been involved in 4 years. So sometimes that can create difficulties. But when you have that staff support and those action plans, that gives the consistency, and it gives the support to the statutory partners as well, that there is something for them to work on. So I think it's been invaluable, but we always have to try and see where the funding is. There is no mechanism that we can say we'll go there for funding again. We have to make a case that it does good things, and I think the good reputation Sutherland has helps us with that.
David, thanks for that. I'm going to come across to Lionel and Ellen. You both kind of touched on where Glasgow Council kind of sits on there, and I suppose for me it would be where does the area partnerships and where do the TSIs kind of sit in the support, or is that support there, or is that something that you think needs to be embedded further in terms of support for the community councils from the TSI and from the area partnerships? Is that something you think is sufficient at the moment, or what would you like to see? And Ellen, I'll probably come to yourself first of all.
Within our area partnership, the third sector interface has a place. Yeah. And sits in our area partnership. I find that the area partnership works very well.
Good.
We know what's happening in our local area. They were supportive during the COVID crisis. However, I must admit, it was the community that pulled together. The community, along with our councillors and MSP, pulled together. I know within the Thriving Places, they were accessing funding for people in their area. We were helping volunteer at food hubs, set up a huge food hub in our local secondary for, I think it was 5 secondary schools in Glasgow, but then the third sector got involved. I was involved as an area coordinator for mutual aid. So the community pulled together. Community Planning Partnership were last to come online. We were having community council meetings. It was actually easier to hold a meeting with our councillors. We had there was a couple of developments going on in the area, so we were all able to go and Zoom. We had done that. Then we were told eventually we would be doing Teams, and we asked for training on it, and we were told how to switch our computer on, basically. But I would say the community and the area partnership works well.
Good.
Our area partnership, and it has been put out by the sector, the community planning, the area partnership should be more informal, but ours has been more informal for many years. We meet locally, we call one another by first names. We're not sitting in Glasgow City Chambers committee room 8 talking in microphones. We all know one another. So, no, I do have a lot of respect for the area partnership. I think they should be getting the funding to distribute and not the sector, if you ask my opinion.
Lionel, anything
I would tend to agree with that. The area partnership works well, I think, mainly because it's only for one ward. So you have four community council members on the area partnership with a third sector person, and they are very active in it as well, and they know the area very well, the third sector person. We also have representatives from the police and the fire brigade, and my gripe is always that these statutory bodies come along, give the report and leave, and then you're talking about something else, maybe about, come back to the low emission zone and the electric vehicle, and you want to have a police view on that, how they feel about giving people tickets at electric vehicles. But they're not there now, they've gone back. So that is a defect with the area partnership, and we've been asking that, you know, the members stay for the full gamut of the meeting. During COVID, you were asking about, during COVID, we continued our meetings online. We had them on Zoom, although if there was a council representative there, it had to be on Teams, but it was usually on Zoom. And to be honest with you, we find generally in our, well, this is a community council, but even with area partnership as well, the best conduit is the councillors. The councillors themselves give us the best support, and they at least have access to the officers and can get us a response. Although, I mean, the responses invariably are kind of standard, you know, it's cut and pasted from somewhere else. Our problems are dissimilar from Ellen's in my community council area. I mean, all our problems are first world problems. So really, you know, we don't have a lot of poverty. We don't have a child poverty or anything like that. But people still have issues, you know. They like to have enough they like to have enough glass recycling for their expensive champagne bottles. but still, we need to have the contact with the people. As I say, the council, I find the area partnership level very useful and helpful, but above that level, we're kind of left out of things.
Thanks. That's really helpful. Thanks, convener.
Thanks very much, Paul. And we're having such a great conversation, but we're going to briefly suspend for a few minutes and then we'll come back on. So this has been such a already such a rich conversation, and I'm going to bring in the next theme, which is local outcome improvement plans and locality plans. And we've already taken quite a bit of evidence on them, and I'd be interested to hear from you around the levels of awareness that these things even exist. I know certainly in my community, people don't necessarily know that there's such a thing as a local outcome improvement plan or even a locality plan. And also to hear from your sense of your experience of local, if you do have experience of locality plans, are they targeting the resources where they're most needed? We've also heard in evidence that the landscape is, in terms of plans that have to be created with communities, with councils, is very cluttered and quite confusing. And I think something that happens is that people seem to get the kind of what we're talking about in terms of community planning partnerships is the services, right? We're talking about the services that are delivered to communities rather than the on-the-ground planning facilities. And I think that also becomes a confusing thing. And then the other piece, which is, I think, an intention around the community planning partnership, is that we're trying to move to a preventative approach, right? It's that what you were talking about, Lionel and Ellen, at the beginning there, about the need for communication so that we can really actually prevent things from emerging, that we're aware of what's going on the ground and in our communities, and that we can move to support people where that's needed to happen. So I'd be interested also, so it's quite a lot I'm packing in here, but I'm interested to hear also if you have a sense of, are we managing to get that preventative approach, through these plans? So a lot in there, and you can pick up whatever bits that have kind of stuck in your minds and you feel you want to respond to. Anybody? Ellen, great.
Well, I am aware, but I don't have much communication with the locality plan. Ours is a thriving place, but I can say that as when they come to our area partnership to discuss their progress, they do seem to do an awful lot of work, a lot of good work, and it's targeted where it's needed. Why? Because they are in the community, they're with the community, and they're part of the community. Their offices are in the shopping centre. As far as I'm aware, yes, they are doing a very good job. Obviously, more money would be wonderful, mm-hmm. but yes, I think they do a good job.
But in terms of your role in the community council, you don't have any opportunity to feed into any of this?
No, that is one complaint that I have seen, because one of them has responded to things. Again, the plans were handed to them. Why were they not involved at the beginning? Mm-hmm. Where I think they're 6 years through the 10-year plan. Of their thriving place, and that's what they're asking for. It's the same, you'll hear it from everybody, involved people at the beginning.
Yeah. Anybody else experienced with the LOIPs, as they're called, shorthand, or locality plans?
Is that the same thing as a local place plan?
Well, that's...
Or is it different?
So my understanding of a local place plan and what's come forward recently is actually the physical planning on the ground that a community would decide, more the kind of physical aspects, and that feeds into your local development plan in terms of, you know, where is housing going to be and that kind of thing.
Well, that's
whereas
exactly
a locality plan, and that's what we're looking at here, is more about the services. So that's why you have on a community planning partnership, you would have the fire service and the police, and they're trying to pull in all of these different bodies that can respond. And I thought it was actually quite interesting. I think it was last week we heard from Fire and Rescue Service, and they're talking about how they're actually working at a community level through the kind of planning partnership to build relationships, because people mm-hmm. trust them and have respect for them. So they're actually doing quite a bit of work around home heat in homes and things like that. So that's that. To me, that's an interesting bit, because that pulls in the preventative aspect, because members of the fire service can get into people's homes and really find out, is somebody living in fuel poverty? What kind of help do they need through Home Energy Scotland, that kind of thing? Lionel.
Well, I'm a bit of a loss here, because I think we feel quite remote from the locality plan. As Ellen says, we've got no input into it. I just about know what it is. Our relationship with the police is quite good, because the police do make an effort to attend the community council meetings. And although they'll sometimes stay to the end, this is my gripe again, you know, we need them to stay the whole course. They'll sometimes stay to the end, which is quite good. With Area Partnership, they will also appear as well, although recently at the Area Partnership we've been meeting online. So what happens is that the... I don't know if I'm going off the subject here, but the police and the other officers, once they've done their bit at an Area Partnership, they will switch off their camera, get on with doing something else, but they're still there to ask a question. And then, but once we go on to face-to-face meetings, they'll want to get away again. Mm. So I would like to have more... I think if we had more input with the statutory bodies, if the community as a whole had more input with statutory bodies, then they would get a feel for what we want and we need. I mean, with the police coming to the to our meetings, they know what our priorities are. And, you know, and they will do their bit to help. But if they don't listen, if they just come and give a report, you know, it comes back to this communication again. Mm. They have to listen.
Yeah. So there's maybe something missing there in terms of, again, I think you've talked about it earlier, about this kind of community representation and some joining up there. I mean, it's interesting to me that you're not really that familiar with LOIPs, local outcome improvement plans and locality plans, and that seems like that's something that it would be good if community councils were aware of them.
Yeah, I mean, we could be more aware of them, but to be fair, from what I've heard of them, there's not a lot of deprivation in our particular community council area. So there's not a lot of organisations looking for funding for deprivation in our particular area. In the next area, in part, I was talking about earlier, then perhaps, yes.
Perhaps, so perhaps there's more active and more awareness of that there. David, you've indicated you wanted to come in.
Yeah, a couple of points there. The first is, although I'm kind of portraying some sort of utopia of community planning, it's not perfect here. And I think that the one area where I think it seems almost universal that there's a bit of a struggle is the engagement between community planning and community councils. And I certainly think that although there are some of our community councils that engage well with community planning, certainly the bulk of them don't seem to feel that it is a requirement, and they do as and when. So some sort of more formal process there might be interesting. In Sutherland, I think we've got 17 community council areas, and when we had locality plans, but because deprivation is harder to record in rural areas, we only actually had locality plans for 5 of the community council areas out of 17. But those worked well, and those were all chaired by different statutory partners. So the Fire and Rescue Service chaired the Kyla Sutherland locality group that we had, and the NHS were chairing, I think, the Brora one. So the statutory partners didn't have an option but to get involved in the locality planning, which I think was good. And they were actually then tasked with reporting back to full partnership meetings on what had happened at the locality meetings and how the action plan was coming along. So they were involved at that level. But what has happened, and I suppose as a result of the recent kind of buzz term of place planning, which I think is a great step forward, but I think the definition of place planning, different people you speak to have different definitions. I think that has to be worked out a bit more. But as a result of COVID, and as a result of the fact that we only had 5 of our 17 community councils represented, but deprivation was present in all of our community council areas, we've moved away from locality plans at community council level area to area forums. So we've got a West Forum, a North Forum, a South and Central Forum, and an East Coast Forum. And those forums then incorporate a wider body of people. Again, they're chaired by statutory partners, but they're making sure that we don't miss any of the areas, and they're bringing probably wider action plans and more effective action plans together. And I think that that is, that's still kind of embryonic. I think the West Forum had its first meeting last night, so we're still working through how that's going to work. But we have hopes that we can create action plans over wider areas that in reality have the same issues. It's the same issues that are facing the different community council areas. So having 17 doesn't make any sense when everybody's talking about homes, everybody's talking about broadband speeds, everybody's talking about childcare. So the area forums seem to work well, but that engagement with the statutory partners as chairs and their duty to report back on the action planning works really well. But engagement with community councils, engaging them in the process of developing the action plans that come out, I think is crucial. So we're just sending out the agenda for the South and Central Area Forum just now, and that has got every chair and every vice chair of the community councils in our area on there. And I think at the last meeting, out of the five community council areas, we have four represented. So hopefully we can help with that by doing this wider area planning.
Thank you very much for describing what's going on where you are. It's very helpful. I almost feel like I need a diagram, though, to kind of follow how it all fits together. I might be getting back in touch with you for that. Louise, do you have any thoughts on the...
Yeah, there's only two pieces I could probably link to. I mean, I really don't have personally much awareness of the wider locality plans. We are involved with Fife Resilience Plan, and we have good links with that, and we've actually created a local resilience plan along with the police and fire that's going down to house level based on the major risks that we see. And that's just about to go live. So if that's an example of working in partnership, then we're doing that. Our local community council is chaired by Peter Aitken. We know him very well and work alongside him and help him with his housing consultations because they are really struggling for members and people not stepping forward in, you know, what is a very valuable way of engaging with the planning aspects of the community. So that I don't want to speak out of turn for Peter, but I know that is his major issue, is just getting people to step forward for this. Hence why we work alongside him to help him with consultations, because he physically doesn't have enough people to do that. And we are okay about that. That's just getting along in a community. But that's my experience so far, and probably not as wide as others.
Thanks very much for that. And I think that also kind of highlights the kind of like maybe an element of a lack of empowerment of community councils that maybe needs to be looked at in terms of funding and whereas development trusts, right, they in a way they got started because this is where communities could actually raise funds and take action and do things that they wanted to do. I'm going to move on to the next theme, which is measuring impact, and Marie is leading on that. Marie.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. As the convener said, I've been looking at the measuring impacts on community CPPs and how they sort of make an impact in communities. I was kind of sorry to hear about your experience in Lionel and Eileen, obviously not much engagement with the community planning partnership and feeling as if you've been overlooked. And that's something we can feed back into our report after we finish our evidence sessions. Do you think that community CPPs target their actions to where they're most needed? I know you kind of touched on that a wee bit, Lionel, but maybe you could expand a bit more.
Well, in theory, they're supposed to, but they need information to do that. So, in the example that we give, the Glasgow Communities Fund, again, they didn't consult with the community. And so it was a very much a paper exercise, even without thinking, well, we need so many food banks, we need so many warm places and so on. And then they just looked, they didn't really look citywide and speak to people. And it was only at the very end when they spoke to us when they realised that they weren't targeting the right areas. Not because they weren't giving money to people who didn't need it, but they weren't sharing it fairly across the city. And I think that was a major problem. And that wouldn't have been a difficult thing to do, because the first thing that we said, which was a no-brainer, is why don't you have a map? And for example, in licensing in Glasgow, they've got a map that shows so that they know what's over-provision and what's not. Why can't they adapt that for the people who apply for grants, Ellen?
But they actually do have a map. There is something called the Glasgow Council Dashboard, okay, which they had come to Area Partnership months beforehand. And when I looked up after the sector review, they do have a map that is run by community planning, and it shows where all the grants allocated. To expand it, and Lionel, at this review partnership, we were told that the people who allocated the grants before it came to us to review had geographic knowledge. They had missed out my entire ward, which is one of the fourth largest area of deprivation in Glasgow. How you can do that? That is why you need to have the third sector and the community involved way before they did. So I think when at that stage it was just, I think they had to change their mind. They had realised that they had got things totally wrong.
Thanks. I was just going to ask a question as well. Like, can you give an example of kind of one thing you feel that the CPPs have achieved in your area? Obviously, if you can't, it's okay, but just one thing you kind of noticed that has been achieved?
No, sorry. Not really, no. I mean, the area partnerships, yes, because they are part of the planning process, yes. I think the area partnerships are, well, so I would say yes. I think more power should be given to them. We do have something in Glasgow that they're looking at called citizens' panels, which, again, is quite a controversial subject, for, especially for community councils. Are we being listened to? We'll wait and see what the outcome of that is.
If I could just follow up on that. So there's two things I want to say. I would agree that in community planning generally, the area partnership is quite successful, because having had experience of their meetings, you feel involved, you feel you're heard, and so on. And not infrequently, let's put it that way, they do take account of what you say. On the other hand, the tiers higher up don't really work for the community as well. They are looking at the moment at these citizens' panels in Glasgow, which is, and I noticed that Bernadette Monaghan spoke about this in her evidence, and there are, there's a group of community, a not insignificant number of community councils who see this as a complete disaster, because what they want to do is enlarge the body so that it will, and it will be made up of third sector bodies, which is a good thing. There's no place for the community council at the moment on it. It will be made up of perhaps local health bodies, local education bodies perhaps as well. And we feel that this is the wrong way to get to the grassroots of the problem. They need to be smart about getting to the grassroots and to reach the people who really need it. And I think the third sector is quite a good way to do that, but they seem not to be taking cognizance of the third sector at the moment.
Thanks for that. David, you seem to have a kind of more positive kind of experience. So I'll just pop the same question to you. I mean, do you think that the CPPs target their actions where they're most needed?
Absolutely, and I think during COVID was a perfect example of that. But coming out of COVID, and actually probably more so in the cost of living crisis and the amount of fuel and food poverty that we've been able to target, raising funding to help people with energy costs, to help people with food poverty, to right across Sutherland, and we're doing that by engaging with the community groups right out there and engaging. It's probably easier in a rural area to engage at the grassroots with the third sector, because they're not as hidden as they are in urban areas. However, we had, I think, 12 groups from across Sutherland visiting us here yesterday to look at our polytunnel, to look at our food larder, to look at all the strategies that we have in place, and they're going to weigh, and we're sharing information with them. So the sharing of information from the successful organisations together is really valuable. But what we've done as well, because we're looking at environmental issues and food security, and we've mapped where there is community growing across Sutherland, and where there is communities where we haven't seen significant community growing, we've actually applied for funding on their behalf to try and help them, to encourage them to have a community growing, to help environmentally, to help with food security, for a number of things. So we certainly, because we are coordinated at a CPP level, are able to target funding to make interventions that really, really work across the area. But again, we're speaking from a smaller rural area with a small rural population, but it certainly is making a difference. And, you know, it is bottom up. It's been led by the communities and the community needs and the community wants. And the partners are respecting that and responding to that rather than dictating what is necessary to happen. And we have had the flexibility to create separate subgroups where we feel that they are necessary to deal with issues that are a real concern for our community. So a good example of that is that in, when we came out of the first lockdown in COVID, which everybody diligently undertook, there wasn't one case of COVID in Sutherland at that point. And then all of a sudden in July, the floodgates opened and there was visitors from all over Britain coming to Highland communities, and the communities lost their confidence in welcoming visitors. And they went from the traditional Highland welcome to taking pictures of people's number plates to try and figure out where they were coming from. And so there was a loss of confidence. So we set up a sustainable tourism subgroup to work with the communities, try and help understand their needs, to try and inform about the best ways to do it and to inform visitors for visitor management as well. And we put out a number of statements on how visitors should behave and how visitors should go forward. And that helped the communities to deal with the issues that we were doing. That group has now fallen by the wayside because the actions that needed to happen are gone. But we've now set up the homes and infrastructure group to look at the housing emergency that we're facing, that, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the depopulation that we are facing, if there aren't homes built, and I'm talking about homes rather than housing that can be lost into Airbnbs, etc. But if there aren't homes for people built, then we're really going to struggle. So we've set up a separate group for that. And again, that is led by intelligence for the community and community engagement. Without community engagement, to me, there is no point in undertaking this, because if you're just dictating policy to communities, communities aren't going to buy into it.
Thank you, David. Just before I move on to Louise, Lionel, did you want to come back in again?
No, sorry, just thought you were speaking.
No, sorry about that. Louise, do you want to come in?
Yes, I don't think we do have proper links to locality plans, and that's in my notepad to go away and have a wee ask about that. But again, following on from David's piece, we too are responding with a subgroup around community assets, which I think its main focus will be affordable housing through the rural housing burden route, if possible. Land's our biggest issue, and that probably isn't the remit of this committee, because we've had issues around the abandoned and neglected clauses in the Land Reform Act, but that's for another committee.
Thank you.
We'll go on and fight that one somewhere else.
Just come back to looking at the impact of CPPs. Excuse me. How should communities be involved in evaluating the impact?
Did you say evaluate it?
Yes, evaluating the impact of CPPs.
I mean, I think there's definitely a role for local authorities to speak to beneficiaries of their facilities and grants. From what I gather, the way it works in Glasgow is they give out a grant and then somebody writes a report saying, you know, at the end of a couple of years, saying this is all going fabulously. Nobody really assesses even a sample of the groups. They just look, everything's done on paper and its outcome. I think there should be more engagement. Actually go out to see the groups, see how they're working, and evaluate them properly, even if it's only a sample.
Thanks.
think it would also be quite good if they gave a report in English, not in council speak or government speak.
Absolutely.
There is a massive difference between speaking to people or talking about locality plans or whatever. They need to speak in English to people so that we understand what they're talking about. It might even be helpful if we did something like some organisations do, what you asked for, you know, what we are doing, what the outcome is. Make it simple. Don't give us 64 pages. I mean, as community representatives, we're volunteers, but we get stuff flung at us from all over the place. Give us succinct, clear outcomes. Well, they, even I've used the word now. But you know, tell us exactly what you've done and where we're going. And I think that would help. And then people would see what they were doing.
Thank you. David, how do you feel that communities should be involved in evaluating the impact?
I think there's a number of things. I think the one thing that we're looking at the moment is longer term planning and getting communities involved in that, looking towards a longer term. I think in the Northwest it's 2045 that they're looking to. So planning for what the communities need in 2045. Again, we're maybe a bit of an outlier. We seem to think that we do engage quite well with that. And as far as the what Lionel was saying about reporting, I think we probably feel that we're reporting to death on a lot of things that we're doing, and so it seems to work okay here. But as far as direct engagement, I think it's crucial. But I think it's crucial that direct engagement isn't done in isolation, so that the direct engagement is done with the statutory partners alongside. So you're not getting a different kind of perspective from the third sector or the communities and the statutory partners, because then you compromise. But I think what we need to do, and what we always try to do, is bring everybody together so that we can reach consensus. Doesn't always necessarily mean as big a compromise that if there's not an understanding of the two sides of things, I think you have to make a bigger compromise. So the communities are essential to this, because without our communities, what are we? You know, there is no need for community planning without our communities. So unless you engage with the communities, unless the communities are at the very least in agreement with what is happening, but in the best case scenario, leading what is happening, and the statutory partners are in agreement of what the community needs are within the parameters of the way that they have to work, that to me is what community planning has to be. And without our communities, I don't think we can plan. So I think it's essential.
Thanks for that, David. Louise, do you want to add in?
I don't think I could make it any better. He said it all.
Thank you.
Thanks, Marie. We're going to move on to our last two themes, and the first one's going to be led by Miles Briggs, and that's the culture of public bodies, and then Willie Coffey's going to come in with local and national leadership. Miles.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard, and I've written down a few comments with regards to attitudes of culture, which you feel hasn't changed. Now, you know, I wrote down here, Ellen, you spoke about feeling like tick box exercise. Lionel, you mentioned feeling left out. And David, you touched upon communities being dictated to. So I just wondered, in terms of how the Community Empowerment Act has actually helped to change a culture, Police Scotland, I think you touched upon, seem to be getting a bit of a green light for their role in actually engaging. Whether or not that's delivered any change, I'm not sure. But I just wondered where you feel that the experience of how public bodies are now feeling they have to engage and then take forward has actually been constructive. Is it just that Police Scotland example, or are there others? Sure.
Or do you want to go first, Ellen?
Yeah, well, within our, again, it's area-wide, we have several projects, again, within one of the SIMDs, where there is cooperation between the police, the fire, the HSCP, the council councillors and when they work together. But again, it's at an area level where we all, where everybody knows one another, and when that happens, it works well. I know that when police come to us at the timing of our meetings in the evenings, we do say to the police or the fire brigade after they've given us a report, you know, please feel if there's something happening elsewhere to leave the meeting. But yeah, in these circumstances at local level, yes, I feel we'll work together.
Yeah, I know.
I noticed from Bernadette Monaghan's evidence that she was saying that the council's no longer the dominant partner. I feel that's just a veneer, that really we have all these processes now, but as Ellen says, it is to a certain extent a tick box. So far as community planning is concerned, it's a tick box exercise. As a community council, we're very grateful for the ability to feed through our issues through the councillors and get our feelings known that way. And as I said before, sometimes they are responded to. But so far as the body is concerned, we still feel that we get a presentation rather than a consultation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. David or Louise, did you want to come in on that point? If not, I wanted to expand to what you've all touched upon in various ways with regard to the pandemic and that emergency response. And I've been quite interested in other work the committee's done at looking at what seemed to be a period of time where some of the barriers were taken away, and maybe kind of that risk-averse nature of sometimes our public services not allowing communities to do what they want and take responsibility. And whether or not you think that's now disappeared, or what worked to make you just do that. You know, you mentioned you all got round a table literally to see what the plan. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm sort of struggling to get my head round, and my sense is that culturally communities are empowering themselves to kind of action plan and then tell the council what they're going to do. I don't know if that is actually what is happening. My sense of that around our resilience plan is what has happened. And it seems to be working. They are open to that and open to work along with what we are going to do, even down to, you know, little cards being placed in windows with emergency details on them. They're saying, that's great. We'll know in that area if we have to go into a house that the details are there and we can help someone. But that's my wider sense, is that if communities start to act for themselves, the councils seem to be open to us doing that for ourselves.
Yeah. In terms of that capacity building, does anyone else have?
I think the initial response to COVID was an instinctive response by the communities. Within my community, yes, and the third sector immediately swung into action. The actual physical community roundabout, probably we were there to support the third sector, because a lot of them had to set up the Zoom, set up this. So we were sort of buffer zone to give them some time to get things set up. And we worked incredibly well. However, people have gone back to work. People that were volunteers, they've got other commitments, schools are back. So no, there's less of that level, I would say. Another barrier to being involved with things is actually, it seems to happen to you, the time that we have meetings. When any meetings are held at Glasgow City Council, they're during the day. People work, and they can't always take time off. If you become part of a committee, say like the area partnership, and then you join a couple of subcommittees, you're committing as a volunteer a lot of time. And nobody objects to committing the time we want to. But the barrier to that is it's all during the day. Mm-hmm. And I think that the council need to open up more to be flexible to people's needs, to, you know, that want to help out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The other thing that I've noticed is that the post-COVID, the authorities are very risk-averse, whereas we resumed face-to-face meetings as soon as we possibly could, the area partnership is still meeting by Teams.
Mm-hmm.
And on the last occasion when I asked them, you know, I've been pressing for a while to have face-to-face, but they're not totally against it, but there's no absolute consensus for it. There's still several members who are still wanting to do it by Teams, which is probably an excuse for something else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, we are face-to-face.
Yeah, we have. Yeah. David, is there anything you want to add, which may be...
Yeah, a couple of things. I may have said the word dictated. It's certainly not our experience of feeling dictated to, but it's certainly something that we want to avoid. So it's not something we've experienced. And as far as the statutory partners are concerned, we get good buy-in from all the statutory partners, but I do feel that often people are promoted into roles without the necessary training and community planning and come to it without confidence in the ability to deliver their role and without a particular experience there. And they are also kind of expected to do that on top of the job that they have. So if you're a chief inspector or you're a head of area for fire and rescue, the community planning is probably not the highest priority that you have, community planning. And I think that to create some space for the people who are engaged from the statutory bodies to be able to engage with it properly and with support for them to do so, I think that would help the statutory bodies to properly and better contribute. So that was what I say from the statutory partners. From the COVID response, I think certainly there was a need from the local authority and from the wider areas to engage with the communities, because at that point in COVID, nobody knew what to do. So the best thing to do was gather evidence from the most local sources that you could get on what the community needs were, and that's local anchor organisations, community councils, whatever it may be. And I think things were made easier during COVID. Certainly from a grant funding perspective, the audit requirement dropped, and it wasn't that things weren't audited and there wasn't a responsibility for properly spending money, but they were certainly less onerous. But that's come back in a vengeance, and it's probably worse now than it was before. So that was a temporary thing, but that worked really, really well for getting necessary resources to areas that needed it quickly and without fuss to deal with issues that were there. So I think that needs to be looked at. And another just wrinkle from the whole process is that most organisations move their application process online. And I think that that can be problematic. And I think that we've embraced quite rightly, and I've mentioned how Teams meetings and Zoom meetings can work in rural areas for getting more people there. I think we have to try and find a happy medium of blend, so we don't push everything online. Because if we do so, then I think it takes away some of that real community intelligence and community interest, because you're not dealing with an officer often anymore. You're just dealing with a screen, and I think that sometimes can hinder the process. So yes, I think the reaction from COVID was superb. The realisation that the communities were the best sources of information to try and deal with what was happening at a local level was really, really useful. So let's not then throw the baby out the bathwater and lose that, because that engagement is really what is important at community planning level, grassroots. Mm-hmm.
That's helpful. Thanks for that. And just finally, you know, what I've taken away, some of the points, Ellen, you've made with regards to area partnerships, and you all know each other. Louise, I think you mentioned some of the success has been around human relationships driving that. So in terms of who's maybe not at the table in these discussions, I think, Lionel, you mentioned third sector sometimes doesn't have the capacity to engage as much. Is there anyone specific you don't think has been able to really get part of this?
Certainly it was pre-COVID at our area partnership. Yeah, we would like to see it expanded. We would like to see, well, my personal view was I'd like to see somebody from the local school to hear the views of the children. Because we're constantly told, you know, youth, 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 but we don't actually hear their voice. so often. We had also asked, especially when it comes to planning, members of, in Glasgow, it's the Glasgow Disability Alliance, get people from that community so that we understand what their needs are. So yes, I think we could engage more people in the process at a local level, mm-hmm. not sitting high up at the city chambers.
Yep. Anyone else have anything they want to add? If not, happy to hand back. Okay. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks very much. Okay, we're going to move on to local and national leadership with Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and what a fascinating discussion that we've had. And quite a contrasting set of views between the rural communities and the urban community in Glasgow. And my theme is about leadership, and I wanted to just get your views and your ideas about what leadership actually is and what successful leadership looks like, and whether you think it's still a kind of hierarchical dominated by the councils, as leadership demonstrated top down, and where is your role in that, and who are the leaders that make a difference in the community? So I wonder if I could just touch on these issues, please. Maybe, because I start with you, Ellen. What does local leadership look like? What makes a successful community planning partnership in terms of leadership?
I think somebody who listens and involves people throughout. And I think, in a way, that's why, in my opinion, the area partnership works far better than the community planning. It's a smaller area, and we work together. We don't necessarily need somebody to tell us what to do, but somebody who actually takes you along with them and who listens. That's what we want, somebody who listens and acts upon it. It's not just a talking shop, somebody who acts upon what we say.
Okay, Lionel, what does good leadership look like?
Well, I think it's someone for whom I have respect. And when I can think of a couple of my councillors in particular, mm-hmm. my councillors rather than the officials, who we can rely on to help us out when we have an issue. But within community planning, within the statutory body, there's no kind of assessment of any of the leadership, or at least we are not aware of it. There may be some kind of internal review body, but there's no assessment of the leadership of the officers within the council that we're aware of, and there's no mechanism given to us of what's a success and what's a failure. But I do find that, as Ellen has said, if we can trust someone, if they listen and they get something done, they can build your respect, and that is a good leader.
Mm-hmm. Do you recognise leadership when you see it? I mean, one of the previous committees convener, somebody said, we all know what an elephant looks like, but it's quite hard to describe it. Is it quite hard to see and describe leadership actually taking place? Is that a difficult thing to define, or is it kind of obvious? And if you've got it, you know it, and if you don't, you also know that you don't have it.
Well, so in the context of the area partnership, for example, I wouldn't say necessarily that any one person is a great leader, but there are people who support us, whom we can rely on, and whom, you know, and who we will follow.
Okay.
I can't really give any more than okay. that, really. I don't know quite what you mean by a leader in that respect.
Okay. Right.
If you're saying, is it someone who will inspire us okay. to do something, I don't think that's someone I've come across.
Okay. It's really interesting. I'll just go over to Louise from Largo. What does effective leadership look like for you? I mean,
responsiveness and you know, prepared to engage in a bit of dialogue to really find out what the issues are and then to point us in the right direction, you know, to be honest about what they can and can't do, you know, therefore we know what falls back on us to use our leadership in the community. Mm. It's a huge question, actually.
I mean, do you feel that it's still very much driven by the local authority, or do you genuinely feel a participant in that process? I think from our colleagues in Glasgow...
We're completely the other way. I feel that we just take the bull by the horns and do our bit, and then we apologise later if we've stepped on toes unwittingly. But that just might be what our communities become. And there's lots of leaders in our community, I would say, who will make links and who, you know, if we put out a call, we'll say, yep, we could pick up with that. We know someone in that area. And if those who are in the organisations like the council are prepared to be responsive and honest, then we've got the best thing to work with, whether they can do something or not. But to be able to say, yeah, I can help there, or no, that's probably not an area that we'll get much traction on right now, but here's what we could do. That's so helpful to us.
When you described earlier on that sometimes you don't let the councillors in, that's quite an empowering thing to say. And
we feel we can.
Like where you guys are, you feel as though you're in control of a process, you can contribute. But that's not leadership, that's something else. That's a different dynamic that's going on there.
It's not that we don't want them there. It's that we feel we should make some decisions at community level without their input first about what we need. And then we actually engage with asking for what help we need, rather than... because a lot of that we can do ourselves. We don't need to be a burden on the services if we can do a lot ourselves. But where we want them is when, you know, for instance, around the resilience plan, we absolutely will involve them. But they're not, you know, an MSP is not needed down at sort of community pathways level. We would go to Fife Coast and Countryside Trust, chat to the people that are involved there and get them involved directly, which means there isn't the double leg going to the council and then to their hands, you know, they're at what do you call an organisation like that? Arm's length, that's what I was looking for. An arm's length. So there's leadership in all of these organisations.
Okay.
Good leadership in many of them, and it's about us connecting where we need to.
Okay, thank you for that. David, up to you. What does effective leadership look like from your experience?
The way it works with us is very much, although we have a kind of anointed chair, it's a collective and it's a team dynamic, and leadership is spread so that it isn't falling to one person. It's interesting because, as I mentioned earlier, so for our area forum, the Police Scotland is the chair, and it's the chief inspector for the area who gets the chair. And I think we've gone through four. I think it's five earlier. I think it's four that we've been through in the 5 years we've been involved. Only 50% of them I went to school with. So, so you do see different styles of leadership. But as I said earlier, because the community planning and this type of working isn't naturally in the experience or skill set of somebody who has become a very, very senior officer because they're good at other aspects of policing. They rely on the team, and I think that the team is important. So we certainly help there. We also have more strategic groups. From a council perspective, we have our councillors. There's only six councillors that we deal with. To a man, leave, I would say, their party hats at the door when they come to community planning, which I think is really useful because they are really reactive to what the community wants. And we deal at a staffing level at the Highland Council with the ward managers rather than senior staff. And it's the councillors that take the lead, and the councillors, therefore, are responsible for their constituents. So it seems to work that way as well. But I mean, for me, leadership is commitment and support for each other. And as long as you see the commitment, there are people who, as I said earlier, don't have huge amounts of experience in partnership working. But as long as they show commitment and respect for the other people there, that's good leadership. And I think that, you know, we are in a position where people are listening to the anchor organisations and the grassroots organisations at the bottom. And often you know, I'll have councillors or council staff phoning up us and say, what do we need to do? And that input comes in from the level that we have. So involving the communities in the strategic direction and showing respect for that, I think, is a huge thing. Respect, commitment and support. That's good leadership.
OK. Thank you so much for that. Have we any time or have we run out of time, convener?
A few minutes, a couple of minutes.
Right. Just to lastly maybe ask you about, I mean, there is national guidance on this in terms of the Community Planning Empowerment Act and so on. Are you aware of it? You know, and does it need to change? What kind of recommendations might you have to improve the experiences you're having just now, Ellen?
I read it yesterday. I have read the Community Empowerment Act. There's certainly a lot of words in it.
How do we improve it?
Make sure people follow it.
Mm-hmm. And listen.
And listen. Mm-hmm. And involve people.
Okay.
Yeah, I would highlight that. Better communication, better involvement at an earlier stage with the grassroots, and proper follow-up afterwards.
Okay. Thank you. Louise, national guidance?
Yeah, I don't really have anything else to add other than what Lionel and Ellen have said. I don't know the act inside out, so...
Okay. David, lastly, over to you. Any final recommendations on improving the process?
I think, again, from a rural perspective, we understand what community planning is there to do for inequalities, etc. It's very much dealt with at a community level, but in rural areas, businesses are a huge part of the sustainability of communities going forward. And I think we have to find a forum or a way of engaging businesses with community planning at a level of respect that without the businesses, without the jobs, without the income, without their ability to trade in our rural areas, communities can't survive. But I think community planning has, and I suppose the place planning that we're all moving towards is maybe the first stage of that, that allows us to engage and look at what the community needs holistically. But I think if we take that out and we're trying to deal with inequalities without engaging with how we deal with and in the future, inequalities by creating better jobs, by creating careers for people, by allowing businesses to maybe and be involved in solving the housing situation in rural areas, I think we're missing a big part of what makes communities sustainable. So maybe if there is some sort of tweak that allows what is recognised as anchor community businesses or something like that to engage without the threat that the businesses are then going to, you know, take everything from it and give nothing back. We have to be respectful of the fact without businesses, the communities can't survive, and without communities, the businesses can't survive.
Okay. Thank you very much to all four of you for those contributions. Thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Willie. And that concludes our evidence for today. And I just want to thank you all for coming in and David for joining us online. I think it's been really helpful to hear your perspectives as we kind of continue to take this process of community planning partnership evidence further, and that will richly add to our report. I've certainly been making lots of notes, and I heard that colleagues also have been making lots of notes, so thanks very much for that. And now I'll briefly suspend to allow the witnesses to leave. The next item on our agenda for today is consideration of the following negative instruments. Valuation for Rating, Plant and Machinery, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023, and Town and County, Town and Country Planning, General Permitted Development and Use Classes, Scotland Miscellaneous Amendment Order 2023. There's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Members will note that we wrote to stakeholders inviting views on the General Permitted Developments SSI, and a couple of responses are included with the meeting papers. If members are agreed, we could write to the Scottish Government seeking further information on how the safeguarding process will work in practice and whether councils offer clear procedures for raising concerns and complaints as suggested by RNIB Scotland. Do members have any comments on the instruments? Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I would say I'm still a little concerned about the permitted development one, and I don't feel sufficiently clear that there are sufficient safeguards in that measure. The Minister did say that it doesn't disapply controls about obstructions, but that doesn't still tell me that councils can just go ahead with this, irrespective of the community views or the impact of that. So there's a little bit of lack of clarity in the middle ground for me and near Ariane about whether people can object to something or participate in a decision, or the council should assess an application. So it's still not clear for me, I'm afraid. It still gives me a little bit of concern.
So we can seek reassurances in the letter, yes.
That you outline there would be supported by me.
Miles.
I agree with what Willie said there. I think there's some real need for guidance to be quite specific and for all councils to follow that. I met with RNIB last week on a separate issue, and we were discussing the use of ropes, for example, to create these areas. There's no real guidance or clarification over what that looks like, and that's one of the key barriers which blind and visually impaired people often raise. So I think it's important we make sure that guidance is very specific if this goes ahead.
Okay, so taking your comments into consideration, would you like some oral evidence? Come back.
I think it would be welcome.
I think for so many people, I think this is, something they want to make sure they have, firstly, have inputted in, but also that this doesn't have unintended consequences when it's rolled out. So I think that would be helpful.
Yeah, I think it would be helpful too. Okay, is that one? So just to clarify, would you like to hear from the Minister on what's going to be rolled out, or would you like us to bring in organisations like RNIB?
I think probably just get the Minister in, because we've read their submissions there and their concerns.
Good.
Just bring the Minister in.
So let's get clarity from the Minister. Thanks very much for that. Yeah, well, that's right. We will get clarity in a few days' time on that one.
I don't know if ahead of that, if we can as we ask the Minister to attend, whether or not they could provide the guidance for us to be able to specifically look at what's then going to be rolled out. Mm-hmm. As with short-term lets, misinterpretation of that guidance can take place. So I think that would be helpful for us to look at that before questioning the Minister as well.
All right. Well, let's see if that's possible.
To, the change of use as well. And obviously, other than the premises are in close proximity to dwellings, obviously it's just the interpretation of that guidance. So we can maybe speak about that as well.
All good points. Okay, so we need some more clarity and we want some upfront information. Thank you very much for that. Thanks very much for that. So I think we can just move to closing out. The valuation. Okay, so just want to check that those comments were all on town and country planning. Are there any comments on the valuation for rating? Nope, no comments on that one. Okay, thanks very much. So we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next item in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.